Friends. put your hands together and worship him this morning.
Every word of worship with one accord.
this morning and to be celebrating your love and your name and your son, Jesus. For your word declares that God so loved the world that he gave. Father, we're so grateful for that gift. And Father, we just want to give a gift of ourselves back to you this morning. We just want to celebrate and thank you that you show us what it is to be loved, what it is to be cared for. You are the epitome of fatherhood. And Father, we celebrate you this morning. We celebrate your love. We celebrate your grace, your mercy, your kindness. We celebrate your provision for our lives. And this morning, we just thank you. Not because of what you do, but because of who you are. Thank you, Father. You are a good, good Father. And we celebrate you this morning. In Jesus' name.
Who I am, who I am. Father does. He shows us everything we need to do. He shows us right here in His Word. He shows it to all of us the way He moves in all of our lives. Isn't our Heavenly Father a good, good Father? Boy, it's good to be in the house of God. It is good to worship Him and just celebrate what He's done. He's a good, good Father. So we're going to pray over our dads, and then we're going to give out one of these little goodies we got. The guys, you keep playing with these till you get home. Put this in your pocket and be good, okay? So just stretch your hands this way, and we're going to pray. Lord, we just thank You, Father. Lord, you represent stability. Father, you represent provision. You represent protection. Lord, you represent authority. Lord, you represent that rock, Lord, that doesn't move when there's turbulence in our home, God. You represent just the solid rock that does not move at all when the wind blows and the waves come against us. And when the drought comes and all the things that happen, Father, in life. So, Lord, we draw off of You and who You are. We thank You for all these men here, Father. We thank You for the anointing that's on each of our lives, God, to be fathers, to be dads to our families, Father God. But we just thank You and praise You, Father God, for all that You have done and that You're doing in our lives. And we pray that You go with us, God, Lord. Help us to be more like You and to follow Your examples, to be the best dad that we can be in Your name. We thank You and praise You in Jesus' name. Amen.
God is good, amen. guys are going to be emptying your closets and cleaning up for the winter, changing this and changing that. I know I'm not the only one. But December 1st, Jeremy, the guy who was here and he was blind, we want to have a truckload of stuff to take to them. So the barn, the building is empty. If you want to put stuff in there, there's a key in the office. We would love to bless them with some, not just clothes, but furniture and canned goods, whatever you have, let's take it out there. If you want me, you got my number. If the barn and you can't get in the building, leave it in the church. I'll get it. Put it out, someone put some stuff behind the building. I got out and put it in the building. So we're looking for a great, great return.
About all the fathers that we have in our lives, the ones that are still here, the ones because I knew what that feeling was like on the first Father's Day. It's a blessing, man. It is a blessing. So, I'm on, ladies, on Father's Day, I'm going to start off with what's going to be called the men's thesaurus. So you can have a little bit of insight as to what we are thinking when we say certain things in our households. Are you ready for this? Ladies say, I'm ready. Men say, oh boy. All right, here we go. The men's thesaurus. When a man says, it would take too long to explain, what he really means is, I have no idea how this thing works. Amen? When a man says, take a break, honey, you're working too hard, what he really means is, I can't hear the game of the vacuum cleaner. Can I get an amen? When a man says, that's interesting, dear, what he really means is, are you still talking? When a man says, it's a God thing, you wouldn't understand. What he really means is, there's no rational thought pattern connected to this, and you have no chance at all of making it logical. Honey, you ready for this one? When a man says, can I help with dinner? What I really mean is it ready yet? Amen? When a man says, sure, honey, or yes, dear, what he really means is absolutely nothing. That's just a conditional response. When a man says, I'm going to skip those two. When a man says, I can't find it, what'd you say? When a man says, I can't find it, what he really means is, it didn't fall. I always get tickled with this because it's exactly what she said. When I say, I can't find it, what it really means is, it didn't fall into my outstretched hand, so I'm completely and utterly clueless. Women, can I get an amen? When I can't find something, she says, check the drawer. And I go and I look at the drawer. You got to open it, and I open it, and I look inside of it, and I don't move anything. And all the ladies said, amen. Amen. When a man says, honey, I heard you, what he really means is, honey, I have the foggiest clue of what you said, and I'm just hoping desperately that I can fake it well enough so that we will not spend the next 3 days of our lives with you yelling at me. When a man says, honey, you look terrific, what he really means is, oh, please don't try on one more outfit. We're late and I'm starving. When a man says, we're not lost, honey, I know exactly where we are. What he really means is, no one will ever see us alive again. When a man says, honey, that's not what I meant, what he really means is, if something I said could have been interpreted two ways, one of those ways makes you sad or angry, and I meant the other. I think about what it meant for me being in the delivery room that night. And it was a long process, but nevertheless, you endure through the night. And that's what it was for me. It was an all-night process. You endure through the night. But when you first hear that cry of that baby, it's an awesome, awesome, awesome feeling. It's a miracle to watch. Of course, not every father's always went to the delivery room. Some people have chosen to stay outside. There's nothing wrong with that. You ever hear the story of the four guys who were out in the delivery waiting room? The nurse came out and said, congratulations to the first guy. You've had twins. He said, man, that's pretty cool. You know, that's odd. I work for the Minnesota Twins. It's weird. Next nurse comes out to the next guy and says, congratulations, you had triplets. And I said, man, that's odd. I work for a company that does 3D graphics. That's amazing. Next nurse comes out to the next guy. Said, congratulations, you had quadruplets. He said, you know, that's so weird and strange. I work at the Four Seasons Hotel. Last nurse come out. The guy's over in the corner just banging his head against the wall. What's wrong with you, man? I work for 7-Up. All right, Ezekiel, chapter 22. Verse 30. Can we stand for the reading of God's word? Hallelujah. Ezekiel 22:30. So I sought for a man. Everybody say man.
Man.
Everybody say man up.
Man up.
So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found no one. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for this worship experience this morning. We just pray for your blessings to fall upon this house today. We ask you to bless our pastor and his wife as they're off, God, getting rejuvenated. We just pray, God, that you would just give him a refreshing of spirit, Father God. Rejuvenation of spirit. Father, we pray for each and every person in this room and the ones that are not here. We pray for your safety, for your provision. We pray, God, that your word goes forth this morning. That you would hush me up, Father, and speak through me. God, that we would just be absolvers of your word this morning, Father. We would just take in everything that you would have for us today. As we celebrate Father's Day, we celebrate you, the ultimate Father. And this morning, Father, we just pray in Jesus' name that we can learn to man up. We just love you, we praise you, we thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name we pray. And the whole church said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. And we'll read it one more time, Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found no one. Church, this morning, God is saying the same thing. It may not be back in the time of Ezekiel. It may not be under these particular circumstances. It may not be with these things on the line. But we have to realize this morning that God is saying the same thing. I'm seeking for a man. Now, ladies, don't take that offensively. Of course, he's seeking for a woman as well, a woman of God, a woman of virtue, a woman of strength. But this morning, as we celebrate Father's Day, he is particularly saying to the fathers and to the men of the church, I am seeking a man. Seeking a man to lead your family. Seeking a man to lead your church. Seeking a man to lead your workplace. Seeking a man to lead in gathering people for him. God is seeking men and women of God to stand in the gap. To stand strong. To stand firm. To constantly keep on the right path, to constantly, when you mess up, know how to stand up. to constantly know how to build barrier walls around your family, spiritually speaking. We are the priest, and we are the priest of our homes. We are responsible as fathers, as husbands, of standing in the gap. We are responsible. God has called us to stand in the gap. One of the biggest issues facing the American school system today is not the behavior of children, but the behavior of adults who raised those children. Can I get an amen? It's not the biggest problem today isn't the behavior of the children. After all, they are children. It's the behavior of the adults that influence those children. You'll never know the impact that you truly have on your child's life until you realize and you see somebody who hasn't had that in their lives. There may be many in here who Father's Day is a bad situation for you, not a situation, a bad memory for you, because your father wasn't that person that stood in the gap. They wasn't that person that built that wall. They weren't that person of strength. They weren't that person that you looked up to for influence. My advice to you today is forgive. Maybe you were that father who wasn't always there. Maybe you were that father who didn't always set that a good example. My message to you this morning is forgive and start over. But maybe you're that father who just had a child or is raising a child now. Or maybe you just got married and you're thinking about having a family. Or maybe you just want to be a better person. Maybe you're a teenager or a child yourself in this room right now, and you think that you know what you want to do in life. Your dreams are set out for you. You're ready to take on the world, as they say. My message for you this morning is follow the example of the men and women of God that He's put in your life. The men of this church, the women of this church, the men that have positive influence in your life. But God is saying to you, like He said in the book of Ezekiel, I am seeking after a man. I'm seeking somebody that's going to stand strong. I'm seeking men and women of God this morning that will do three things. And the three things are as follows. Number one, He's seeking after men who will lead. He's seeking after men who will lead. And He's seeking after men who will love. But you see, you have we learn how to lead others to Him. And we learn how to love through Him. Amen? Yeah. How important it is in today's culture, in today's society. And I see students all the time, particularly young boys, who struggle because they haven't had. But I'm here to tell you this morning that God is a father to the fatherless. Maybe you're here this morning and you're struggling with this very idea of looking up to your own father. Look to God the Father, because God has called you to be a positive influence. God has called you to be a positive example, to be a positive role model to your children and to today's society. We will reference several verses today. You don't have to turn there. You can certainly turn there if you want to. But what does it mean to be a godly man? What does it mean to be a good father, a good husband? What does it mean to lead in love? Well, let's talk about those things this morning. Number one, what does it mean to lean on God? Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, and always acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths." Now, how many can testify to that truth this morning, that if you lean on Him, He will direct? If you lean on Him, He will lead. If you lean on Him, He will love. He will deliver. He will set free. He will heal. He is a God that still shows up on the scene. Amen? Lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways. He shall direct your paths. All too often in today's society, men lean upon their own knowledge, upon their own passion, upon their own ambition, upon their own ideas of what being a good man should be. That we forget, that we neglect what God says a good man should be. See, you have to first of all realize that there is no good without God. In the book of 2 Peter, he talks about the characteristics of being a good person. And he says, first of all, you must have virtue. You must have faith. You must do what God has called you to do. But you must realize that you cannot perform these things, and you cannot work your way into being good. Only God is good. Even Jesus said as much. "Call us not me good, for there is only one good, and that is God the Father." So what are we leaning on as men? What are we leaning on as women? What are we leaning on as children of God? Number one, we lean on God for salvation. There's somebody in this room who's been praying for your father. Somebody in this room has been praying for somebody in your family. You lean on God for salvation. He will save them. He will deliver them. He will set them free. Lean on Him. The book of Ephesians chapter 2 verses 8 and 9 says these words, "For by grace are ye saved through faith." Now listen to this. "Not of yourselves, for it is a gift of God, not of works." In other words, you cannot earn it. See, we as men want to be in control of everything. We want to work our way towards that goal, towards that whatever it is that we've set our mind to. But we can't work our way to salvation. But we have faith through Him who gives it. Then the Bible says there in the very same scripture, verse 9, "Not of works, lest any man should boast." Somebody say, man up. How do you man up? Learn to lean. Learn to lean on the Father. Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 says, "Verily I say unto you, unless you be converted, and become as little children." This is a hard thing for a man to do, because I am stubborn. Guys, I'm sure several of you in this room understand what I'm saying when I say we as men can be stubborn. We want to depend upon ourselves. We want to be independent. We want to make sure that we can do everything in our lives on our own. But the first step to salvation is to realizing that you are mere mortal. And it requires total reliance upon God the Father. You see, the Bible says, unless we become as little children, we shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven unless we become as humble as little children. So what does it take for us? It takes humility. It takes learning how to lean. So we lean on God for salvation. We also lean on God for strength. This is something else that's hard for us to do, because men in their innate nature want to just be strong in their own accord. Be strong for themselves. We don't want to cry. We don't want to show our emotions. We want to be the epitome of strength for our family. But strength comes from the Father. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 30 through 31 says, "Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men," somebody say man up, "shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength." How difficult is that in our lives sometimes? Because when we want something, we want it now. We don't want to wait. But the Bible says those that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. You see, we, in our stubbornness, take it upon ourselves to put the burden of everything upon our own shoulders, when Christ already did that for you. Maybe you're here this morning and you're worried about your child. Maybe you're worried about your spouse. Maybe you're worried about a family member. And there's nothing you can do about it, because this one is out of your control. Learn to lean. Learn that your strength comes from Him. What else do we learn to lean on this morning? Well, we learn to lean on Him for salvation. We learn to lean on Him for strength. Here's another issue that men struggle with. We learn to lean on God for supply, because we are the breadwinners. We want to work. We want to make sure that we provide a good home for our family, that we give things to our children. But the reality is that if you lean on a job, if the job goes, then where's your faith? Don't rely on a job or workplace as your source of supply. Rely on Him who shall supply all your need, according to Philippians 4:19. You see, we want to be the mighty hunter, men, right? We want to be that source of supply and the provider. But ultimately, we need to see our own selves as being in God's hands. Amen? Are you in God's hand this morning? So we lean on God for salvation. We lean on God for supply. We lean on God for strength. And we lean on God for wisdom. The book of James, chapter 1, verse 5 says, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men," somebody say man up, "liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him." Folks, do you rely on God for wisdom? Wisdom with everything. Wisdom with what to do in this situation. Wisdom to how to be a good husband. Wisdom for how to be a good father. Wisdom for finances. That's the number one problem in marriages in America today, is they struggle, not only struggle with finances, but they worry constantly about finances. Lean on Him for sound reasoning, for So we learn to be leaners. Because the next step to be a leader requires you to first be a leaner. We must learn how to follow before we can ever lead. We must learn how to get our strength from Him before we start influencing others. Number two, men must learn how to lead. What do we have to learn how to lead? Number one, you ready for this? Because this one's going to be a shocker. We must learn how to lead our flesh. This is a challenge for everybody, men and women alike. But we must learn how to lead our flesh. Have self-control. Have perseverance. Have godliness and righteousness. And live a holy life. We as men take so much pride. So much of our pride and pridefulness comes through what we can accomplish. But when we lead our flesh and we realize that we are subject to error, that we're subject to sin without the strength of God. You see, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 and 17 says, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary to one another, so you cannot do the things that you would. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, for Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We must learn to lead our flesh, men, or our flesh will lead us. Amen? We must learn to lead our flesh, or our flesh will lead us. Once we've learned how to lead our flesh, then we lead our families. You, men, you husband, you father, you dad, you man of God, are called to be the head of your house. You're called to lead your family in prayer, in devotion, in studying God's word, in teaching your kids God's will, in teaching your kids the word of God. If we do not teach our children the word of God, I assure you, because I see it every single day, that the world will teach them the way of the world. When you send a child, and I don't care where you send that child, you can send them to public school. People bash public school all the time. It's the same way in Christian schools. Amen, brother? Because you substitute in one, right? You can send them to a public school, a private school, a charter school. I don't care what school you send them to. Doesn't matter. They are influenced. You are responsible for training that child. The Bible says, train a child in the way it should go, and they will not depart. It's your responsibility. Stop putting the blame on the public education system or the private education system. If you want to know why your child is acting up, it's because you have to raise them the way that they should go. This coming from a father, this coming from an educator, this coming from a minister of God, I'm telling you today that unless we start manning up and leading our children in the way they should go, then all bets are off the table. Anything can happen. And then you're going to look back and you're going to wonder, what went wrong? Lack of training our kids. We must do it. Not only a moral obligation, we have a godly direction to lead our children. We must man up. Take responsibility. Take action. Realize that if there's multiple heads of the family, and what I mean by that is if you're letting TV rule your family, or you're letting this idea or notion, then all you've got is a two-headed or three-headed or four-headed monster. Because when you've got multiple heads running a family, then all you've got is a monster. Take that role today. I remember my dad, and again, going back to some of my own experiences, I remember our dad having Bible studies in the home, and us doing worship services and having services in the living room of our homes, and I thought the man was weird as all get out when I was a little kid, but we would take communion in our home and do foot washings in our home, and I know that probably sounds strange to maybe some of you, but what that was being a leader by example. Lead your home. So we're responsible for leading our flesh. We're responsible for leading our families. And we're responsible for leading others to Jesus. This is our number one responsibility. This is our number one Christian obligation, is that we lead other people to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Hosea chapter 6, verse 7 says, "But they, like men," somebody say, "man up," "have transgressed the covenant. They have dealt treacherously against me." We as men are wretched things, aren't we? We as human beings, our righteousness, the Bible says, is as filthy rags. But we must lead others. So we must learn to lean, we must learn to lead. And ladies and gentlemen, men and women of God, we must learn to love. Now this is a simplistic, this is a very basic element of the Christian faith that is the hardest to grasp onto. Of course we're going to love our children. Of course we're going to love our spouses. But are we going to love others? Are we going to show the love of Christ over here and over here and over here and over here and at every avenue and every aspect of our life? Are we going to love? This is a hard thing for even me. Because sometimes you just don't want to love somebody else. Sometimes it's the hardest thing in the world to show compassion and to show love for somebody who has wronged you. But the Bible says, love your enemies. How will you expect your children to show love if you don't show love? I'm not saying be overly tolerant of sin. I'm not saying be accepting of sin. I'm saying love. The only way we're going to reach a lost and dying world is to love and reach after them. To extend the arm of God. To extend His love. To extend His passion. We must first of all learn how to love the Father wholeheartedly. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 22, if a man, somebody say manna, love not the Lord, let him be accursed. 1 Corinthians 13, 3, though I speak with tongues of men, of angels, and have not love, I am a bunch of noise. That's the Jason McGuire summary of it. We must learn to love the Father. Of course we must learn to love our families. How can we lead without love? You see, we mentioned families when it came to leadership. But the true mark of leadership is in where their heart is and where your love is. We must realize this. The last thing that I want to discuss this morning is learning how to love in fellowship. Learning how to love inside the church. Learning how to reach out. And this is what we spent the majority of the time last Sunday night talking about, is because how many countless people walk through the doors of countless churches and they sit down and they're not feeling the compassion of God. They don't feel the love of God. It's because we, as men and women of God, particularly today, we're talking about men of God, we don't love others. I'm not talking about life, church, but then again, I might be. We need to love. We need to reach out, and we need to make sure that everybody feels the love of God. Everybody feels the love of the Father. Men, father, dad, husband, man of God, it's time to man up. I want to read one more time. Ezekiel 22:30. So I sought for a man. I sought for a man who would make a wall, who would stand in the gap, but I found no one. I pray today that you answer his call this morning. Because he's saying to you, I'm seeking after a man. I'm seeking after a woman. I'm seeking after a child of God who will make a wall, who will stand in the gap. Dads, happy Father's Day to you. We love you. We appreciate everything that you've done in our lives. We appreciate everything that you are, all that you represent. Realize that you represent the Father's love. I never knew how to love. Dustin, you said this a while ago. You never truly know what love is until you lay your eyes on that child for the first time. That's a different kind of love. It's a different kind of bond. It's a different kind of love in general. But we are to represent God's love. We men, we dads, we husbands are to represent the love of God to every child. So this morning, I want to ask us all to stand. And as we conclude, and my Father's Day gift to you is to get you to Buffalo Wild Wings before the crowd gets there. Amen? As we conclude today, remember, it's time to man up. We are the example of God's love to our children. We are example of God's love to our wives. We are an example of God's love to the people in our lives. If everyone would just bow your heads and close your eyes this morning, I want to offer an opportunity. Certain ministers do this in various ways, and I just want to offer this morning, because one of the things that I said today in the message was that to be an effective man of God, you had to learn to lean on Him. And the first thing you have to learn to lean on Him for is salvation. And so with every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm going to ask, is there anybody in the room who needs to make Jesus the Lord of your life, needs to surrender and lean on Him this morning? Would you raise your hand? Is there anyone here this morning who needs to find salvation? Then praise God, we're already saved. All of us are all saved, so we should be leaning on Him. So the next question I'm going to ask this morning is, how many men, women, you too, how many men of God in this room have said or can say, I need to lean more on you, Father? How many can say that this morning? See every one of our hands. And so what we're going to do is we're going to open up the altars. If you want to come, you don't have to come to the altar. Let's just pray together for a moment. And let's learn how to lead. Because if you're ever going to lead and you're ever going to love, you first of all have to learn to lead. And let's just lift our hands together. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And again, the altar is open if you want to come. But let's pray together in the name of Jesus. We can learn to find strength by leaning on Him. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for every father in this room. I pray for every husband in this room. I pray for every man of God in this room. As they set the example and they set the tone for their families, as they set the example and they set the tone in their own lives, I pray that you strengthen them. God, I pray for every woman of God in this room, that they will follow the leadership, first of all, by the Father in heaven, that they follow the leadership of their husband, their spouse, that they follow the leadership of their own earthly father, but making sure that that leadership lines up with the leadership of God the Father. And Father, I pray in Jesus' name that every man, that every woman, that every child that hears this message this morning would just grow stronger and learn to lean on you. Thank you for all you do in our lives as we celebrate you, as we celebrate your love. Celebrate our fathers today. We just thank you that you are the ultimate example of leadership.